a great privilege and a pleasure to be here with you today, and thank you to my friend David, who's set this all up and so on. And it's a fantastic thing to see you here, because when we have a lot of shame about appearance and so on, it takes an awful lot of courage, really, to come forward and start to kind of explore the experiences that you have, because we get very locked in with fear and concerns that we won't be accepted or be rejected. So it's wonderful to see you all here and reaching out to each other. It's wonderful. Okay, so what I'm going to be doing then is talking a little bit about compassion-focused therapy to body shame. And we're also going to be looking at an evolutionary model. Now, I just want to check on the times. Do you want me to shorten it a bit? Keep to the times? No? Okay. Okay, so just to remind us then that we are part of an evolutionary species. There we are. We have that up there. We haven't been here for very long, and we share many of our genes with many other animals. Now, this is important because the way our bodies and brains are has been designed by evolution. This is a very famous evolution theorist you may know. And he told us that all of the things that happen in our bodies and our brains are there because of natural selection. Now, this is quite an important story, because what natural selection is about is setting up strategies, feelings, motives in your mind to do specific things. And the two main things are survival, so you have to be able to eat and find shelter. But the other main thing is reproduction. And part of reproduction is ensuring, particularly for mammals, that the individuals that you give birth to will survive. So that leads to attachment. And we'll have a look at that later. So the key thing then is everything about you has been built for you by your genes. You have two arms and two legs. You didn't design any of that. That's been designed for you by your genes. Your head is full of a whole lot of stuff. Capacities for rage, anxiety, sex, tribalism. You didn't build any of that. That's been built by your genes. We also know that the life that you experience according to the pattern of genes that you have will have a very big impact on the version you become. Your gene expressions can even be changed by the experiences of your environment. So if I had been kidnapped as a three-day-old baby from hospital where I was born in the Gambia, actually. So I'd been kidnapped and I was raised in a violent drug gang. This version of Paul Gilbert would not exist. A very different version of Paul Gilbert would exist. Possibly someone who was himself very violent, might even be dead by now, could perhaps be very rich. Who knows? And it's very, very difficult for us to realize that, you know, we are just versions of ourselves. And there are thousands of potential versions that you will never live because you never had a chance to live them. So when we work in our therapy, we always remember this is a version. And that the version that we are trying to help people to develop, of course, is a compassion version. And a compassion version will reorganize a whole range of things in your mind. So this is important then, that everything that we experience in these ways, it's not your fault. This is very important. It's not your fault. You didn't design your body. You didn't design to have two arms. You didn't design the emotions that go on in your brain. You just have a mind that's come in to this biological experience of being. We're all basically bits of DNA that we've got above our station, but there we are. Now, the point about it is it means that if you follow an evolutionary trail, in our minds we have a whole range of motives and emotions and behavioral tendencies that go way back, millions and millions of years. And as part of this, we have at least three forms of emotion, three different types of emotion. One is your threat system. Your threat system is your most dominant system. More processing power, energy, is given over to threat processing than anything else. You also have two types of positive emotion, which we will look at a little later. One is drive, which gives you excitement. And the other is a form of positive emotion, which is a calming emotion. And this emotion is related to a sense of contentment, but also to a sense of connectedness. And the green system, the green emotional system, is the system that we're particularly interested in when we do compassion-focused therapy. And when we do the workshop later, I'll explain how that works. So your threat system is your dominant system, and it will get hold of your cognitive processes very easily and very quickly. So an example we often give is, imagine that we go Christmas shopping, and you go into 10 shops, and in 9 of the shops, the people are extremely helpful to you, and then in one of the shops, the assistant is very rude. They make you wait, and then when you say, excuse me, could you serve me, they say, patience, sir, patience. So you just feel, can't you, the headbutt is getting, you're getting ready for the headbutt. But anyway, then they serve you and they don't seem that bothered, and then you give them £20 and they give you change for 10, and you say, I gave you £20, and they say, I can't tell you how many people pulled that trick on me, sir, you only gave me 10. So you're pretty cross. Who are you thinking about when you go home? When your partner comes home and they say, what kind of day did you have? Who do you talk about? See? So you're still angry about it. And then you make them, my God, did they treat you like that? That's terrible. Where do they get these people from? With all the unemployment, couldn't they find somebody better than that? Right? So now we've got two people here. Both your blood pressures are going up, your heart rate's going up, your stomach acids are going, right? You were hoping for a romantic night, but you're too pissed off for that. So. And if we rewind it, and we all know it's true to a degree that we focus on the negative because 90% of the people that day were helpful to you. Why don't you ruminate on that? Because your brain's not designed to. Your brain is designed to focus on threat. That's what it's designed to do. That's a little problem, right? And that's one of the reasons that over 50% of people in the Western world will have some kind of mental health problem through their life. And most of those problems will be to do with the way they're processing some kind of threat. So we'll come back to that in a moment. So there we are. You have to prepare for life. And you have to just keep out of harm's way. So threat is a big issue. And David and I wrote a paper about the nature of threat processing in people with body dysmorphic disorder, which you can read and enjoy, I hope. There we are. Now, the other thing that's very important about humans is why do we get ourselves in a tangle is because about 2 million years ago, we started to get smart. And we have a totally different type of brain to many animals because we have a capacity for language and self-monitoring, self-criticism, a whole range of things that animals can't do. And this is great because it allows us to be here and have science, but there's a downside to it. The downside is it drives us seriously crazy. Our new brain is a source of serious problems, very serious problems. And one of the things in the Compassionate Foundation we point out time and again is the human race has a problem with the human brain, partly because it's not very well designed. And that's why we can use our intelligence to do terrible things. The Syrian situation. Think of all the tortures. Think of 2,000 years ago, we used to have the Roman Games. 10,000 people died in the first 3 months of the opening of the Colosseum. Humans are probably one of the nastiest species that have ever existed. Why? Because we can think about doing nasty things. And not only can we think about doing nasty things to other people, we can think about doing nasty things to ourselves. So we create these loops in our minds where our thoughts and our emotions get locked in a loop, and these loops then become like glue. They get stuck. We can't get out of it. So imagine a zebra running away from a lion. There we are. So when the zebra's got away, right, if it's just old brain stuff so the zebra can't smell or hear the lion anymore, then it will settle down and go back to eating. But that tends not to happen to humans because they will be relieved, but then in comes the new brain. They start ruminating. Can you imagine if I'd been caught? Can you imagine being eaten by a lion? They choke you to death, you know. Oh my God, I can just smell the breath of the lion. Oh my God! Can you imagine that? They wake up in the middle of the night. Supposing there are two lions tomorrow. And then they become critical. Why am I living here when I could be in London going to this wonderful conference on BDD? I mean, it's just crazy, right? So the point about it is that human brain is a brain that likes to think, it likes to ruminate, it likes to plan, it likes to anticipate, it likes to guess in a way that no other brain, certainly not a zebra's brain, doesn't. So a zebra doesn't wander around thinking, what about if there are two lions tomorrow, and do I need to do a little bit of exercise to make sure I'm okay? You know, I've got to just get my muscles going here, because you never know when the lions are going to be around. But zebras don't do that kind of thing. Humans do. We also know that your brain is set up to design to be orientated for certain kinds of problems. So it's very easy for us to develop fears of spiders, but not so much electricity, even though electricity will harm us. Social anxiety is, again, quite common. And interestingly enough, most animals do not have social anxiety. And the reason is that because they don't have a sense of themselves. What animals have is paranoid anxiety, as I'll mention in a moment. But we can have social anxiety because we're thinking about us. How are we looking? How are we coming over? What are people judging us about? Separation anxiety is the anxiety that we experience when we're separated from loved ones. So I don't know if any of you remember a time when you were very young and you got lost. Maybe in a department store or on a beach. You could not find your parents. You were lost. Now, if you do that, what a lot of people remember is absolute panic and terror. Complete confusion. They don't know where they are. They become slightly dissociated. The strangers around them aren't going to help them. They need mum or they need dad, right? And this, they start searching and looking for mum and dad. So separation anxiety for some individuals is very powerful. It's being separated from somebody who can help you because you have a biological system that's ready to fire off, right? It fires off. Paranoid anxiety is to do with threats. Social anxiety is I might do something that you will find silly or you'll reject me for, but you're quite nice, really. Whereas paranoid anxiety is actually you're not very nice, you want to hurt me. Hypochondriasis, of course, and depression is related to the feeling of low control, helpless, and so forth. So mental health problems are really related to these dimensions of threat that are partly wired in, and that is then linked to the triggers. What triggers them? How easily are these systems in your brain easy to trigger? How easy could we trigger paranoia in you? What would we need to do to make you very paranoid? How many experiences would you need of people hurting you, cheating on you, to make you paranoid? Frequency, how common do we experience it? What is the intensity of the fear? What is the intensity of the experience or the depression or whatever it is? How long does it last? These are all really important questions that make people's experiences, which are partly built in, very intense and very difficult. Often they can be automatic and involuntary. People don't want them. Nobody wants to feel frightened or have panic attacks about their appearance or other things. They just come unbidden. They're like gate crashers. And they can regulate all kinds of states of minds. And we can also find that people can be very frightened of actually change. They can be frightened of the process of change. They can be frightened of what they might discover. They can be frightened that they might not make it, they may fail. So even in the process of recovery, the new brain comes up with a whole lot of yes buts. See, you have to cope in yes but suppose, yes but suppose, yes but suppose. So therefore there is a key set of dimensions for threat. There's the threat of physical harm, there's the threat of loss of independence and control, there's social threats, being excluded, being bullied, as we heard earlier from Charlotte. But there's also, in some of the people I work with, the fear of fragmenting, just falling to pieces, falling apart, going crazy, not knowing who you are. Now, one of the points I want to try and get across to you, that while we can think about what's happening in the threat system, we also need to recognize what's happening in that affiliative green system. Okay, because in the green system, there's an enormous sense of disconnection and aloneness. If you ask a panic patient who's panicking, do you feel connected and supported by others or alone? They will say alone. If you ask a socially anxious patient when they're feeling very socially anxious, do you feel connected to other people, supporting, or do you feel alone and separate and different? They'll say alone, separate and different. Ask a depressed person. Ask a paranoid person. You know, when you're feeling very paranoid, do you feel connected or do you feel sick? Right the way through, many forms of difficulty is an underlying sense of somehow being different, somehow being disconnected, not part of the flow. And in compassion-focused therapy, we're really interested in those experiences. So yes, you can go after the fears and that, but we are interested in going after this experience of separation and aloneness. So let's come on now to thinking about body shame, which is an area I've done a little bit of work in. We live in what are very clearly understood to be cultures of appearance. And we have to think, what are the domains of culture, of the cultures of experience for people with body dysmorphic difficulties? Well, the first thing to remember is that actually the issue of attracting others into forming relationships with you is right the way through all of the evolutionary process. So plumage, antler size, you know, firefly, the glow in the dark, and all these things, they're all basically sexual attractors. Okay, so in order for animals to come together, they have to attract each other to come together. And that there assumes that there is a judging or an audience to be attracted. And that means that you have to be as sensitive to the mind of the other or aware of the other, not necessarily consciously, but you have to be able to display with an idea of how this is being experienced in the other. So there we are, that's a parrot. It's a peacock's tail. So these are all signals of attraction. They are body displays to impact on the mind of another, which in this case obviously is a potential sexual partner. So evolution is very interested in this whole domain of attractiveness and giving animals these signals where they can then display their stuff. But remember, humans have this amazing intelligence. It's not used intelligently very often, but we have this amazing intelligence. And this means that we can actually alter our presentations on purpose. And this also means that we do a couple of things very, very prominently, which is to self-monitor and self-criticize. Now, with people who have psychosis, the people I work with, they self-monitor their thinking, what's happening, their thoughts, okay, in a particular kind of way, and they come to decisions that maybe those thoughts don't belong to them, they're the voice of someone else. But in cases such as, in situations such as with BDD, the self-monitoring is on the physical experience, but not just the physical experience of how I experience my body, but how somebody else might experience my body. So what's really important then is that when we think about these kinds of difficulties that people have, it's not just here, it's in what we call interactive flow. So there's my judgment of myself as an object, there is my judgment of how others are judging me as object, and there's my judgment of others as objects. And these all interact to give us a sense of and self-experience. So I think as Charlotte was saying, you know, if you have people around you saying, oh, that person's ugly, and you look just like them, that's difficult, right? That's giving you a very clear message that the judgments of others about you is this, okay? So that is going to filter into your own sense of self-judgment. So the key point is to recognize then that we're all socially and culturally contextualized. And therefore, some of the problems that we have in the world, particularly the levels of depression and paranoia and other problems, are partly related to the context in which we are living. And the context in which we are living are highly competitive. Okay, we are seriously skewed towards competitive dynamics. We're doing quite a lot of work in schools now, and many of the children that we're working with are very focused on their need to achieve and achieve and achieve. There's been quite a lot of work looking at changes in children's values over the last 20 years, both here and in America. And children over the last 20 years have become less empathic, more self-focused, more concerned with their appearances on Facebook, and less interested in being helpful to other people. It's very interesting. So competitive then, when you're comparing yourself to other people, this is linked to high self-monitoring. So your attention system is going to be monitoring this process. How am I doing compared to other people? And that is one of the crucial risk factors for shame. So it is the psychology of the look. How do I look? The look, particularly when it comes to body issues, it's the look. the idea of the eyes upon you, the judging look, and also the projection. As Charlotte gave a brilliant demonstration of the projection of the look. I think this is ugly, so you must think this is ugly. So what I think about me, you must think about me. Classic projection. But, as I say, we like to do all kinds of things to our appearance. We put on headdresses and follow fashion. But we can also do some really quite strange things. Okay, so in this situation, in these cultures, individuals have the ring necks, which are regarded as attractive, to the point where actually they cannot survive without the ring necks because they've stretched them too much. This is an example of bound feet. For 1,000 years, mums would break the feet of their young girls to bind them because that was regarded as attractive. I mean, nowadays we think, oh, that's awful, because these young people would live in terrible pain for most of their lives because of this thing called attractiveness, right? It's very, very sad. Humans do these things, right? Humans can be crazy, I have to tell you. Here's another example. Everybody knows this is bad for your backs, it's bad for your hips, it's bad for your feet, but it's fashionable, right? And we all want to be fashionable. So that was me on Saturday night. Now the problem with all of this, the culture of appearance is also a culture of deceit. It is a culture of lies and deceit. So that's important, you know. If we're competing, what the hell are we competing about? We're competing about graphic images. And not surprisingly, this is what happens to some of our young people.
Of her. She's like a Martian.
God, my hips are huge.
Oh, please, I hate my calves.
But you guys can wear halters. I've got man shoulders.
I used to think there was just fat and skinny. Apparently, there's a lot of things that can be wrong on your body.
My hairline is so weird. My pores are huge.
My nail beds suck.
I have really bad breath in the morning.
Ew.
So that is now turning up in TV shows, this increasing obsession with the way in which we look. And a lot of that is partly being driven by a culture of deceit. So we need to address this, right? If we're going to help people with body dysmorphic disorders, we also have to address some of the causes of it, which is, as Charlotte was saying earlier, bullying, but also these ridiculous examples and images that we're supposed to compete with. So we then can change our appearances in lots and lots of ways. We have seen the neck stretching, the earlobes, tongue lobes, foot binding, piercings, plastic surgery, tattooing, makeup. I mean, the body is a real focus of objectification. And the more competitive and the less compassionate our societies become, the more we turn ourselves into objects. And we become frightened that we're not objects, that we're court pleasure. So we think a little bit about shame then. Shame is, particularly for humans, has moved away from this issue of power, and it's become an issue of attractiveness. So all of us want to show our talent. We all want to be accepted and to be liked and to be included and to be wanted because we are valued. So we want to show our talent and so on. We want all of this. We all play the game, don't we? I mean, if you go to a friend's dinner party and they give you a meal, you say to them, so thank you for your wonderful meal. It was a lovely evening. Then you go outside and you go, oh my God, it was good. If you have a new lover, you say, oh, your lovemaking is fantastic. You don't say, well, I've had better, I've had worse, it's okay, it's not too bad. So the desire to be valued, to feel attractive in the eyes of others, this is a basic human need. It's not a pathology. It's a basic human need. It becomes problematic when the old brain and new brain get locked in such a way that actually you become overly focused by your threat system, and it becomes difficult. So when we feel valued, we feel safe with others, we feel they won't reject us, we feel likely to be, they're going to help us in our times of need, we can create advantageous relationships. We also know that when we share valuing between each other, this has physiological effects. Okay, if you look at relationships where they talk to each other in loving ways, hello, darling, how are you today? Hello, the stars in my sky, the reason for my existence, my precious one, I love you. All of that stuff is really quite important because it creates a context of sharing positive signals, and these have physiological effects. So we know, and we have known for a long, long time, that the experience of being valued is very, very important, and therefore tracking that idea that we may not be valued is also very, very important. The problem is, of course, if we get locked in to one specific focus, then that will be a terrible source of threat for us. So if we think about a model of shame, then this is the model of shame that we have. All of us are born with innate motives to be loved and cared for by our parents, to form attachments. We also have innate motives to belong. We are a tribe, we're a very tribal species, which is both good and bad. We want to stimulate positive emotion in the minds of others, but if we grow up with a lot of criticism and a lot of abuse or whatever, and bullying, we can develop what we call external shame. Now, external shame means that it's the shame that we experience because of what we think might be in your mind. So that we learn that actually what's in your mind about me is really important, because if you have a negative view of me, then I will be rejected, I will be out of the group, I will be unvalued, disvalued. And you see it, of course, a lot in religion too, where people worry that God will love them or care about them, so they try to make sure they do things that God will like, because what you don't want to do is to annoy people that can hurt you, okay? The problem is it can then be internalized, in which case, when somebody criticizes you or they have external shame, then you internalize that. So in some places where children are put down for the way they look or ashamed for the way they look, they will internalize that. And one of the interesting points about external shame is that external shame often requires people to learn to be assertive. So in therapy, for example, it's not just that you learn not to be frightened, that you learn to be assertive. So to the bully, you say, you have no right to call me ugly. Okay, that is inappropriate. But if you're young and you're frightened, you don't have access to that capacity to be assertive, to actually stand up. How dare you? How dare you? What gives you the right to call me ugly, you bastard? Right? You can begin to feel some of the rage that sits in some of this fear. Now, why is that important? It's important because the anger system is what allows us to then become assertive. And if we can become assertive, we're no longer frightened. If we can't be assertive and defend ourselves, then the world is a dangerous place. And then the only way we can defend ourselves is by being anxious back here. So external shame is very, very important because it means that we have to be able to learn how to be assertive so that the negative judgments of others frighten us less than they need to. One of the issues, though, is that many people feel they have to compete to avoid being inferior. I have to prove myself in order to avoid being rejected. So we've done quite a lot of work on what we call competing to avoid inferiority. So in our society, it's not just competing to be better, it's actually competing to avoid being rejected. And it's that one which causes all of the harm. So this is a little study. To be valued, I have to strive. Life is a competition. People compare me to others. We call that insecure, whereas the secure striving is, doesn't matter if I fail or not, people will still like me. I don't feel under any pressure to prove myself. You're loved for what you are, not what you achieve or what you look like or whatever. And you won't be surprised to find that for the insecures, what this means is that they tend to feel very inferior to others. Insecures tend to be very submissive, and insecures have a very high level of shame. In other words, they think other people look down on them a lot. They feel very inferior in the gaze of others. And you also, you won't be surprised, that compared to secures, the more stressed, the more anxious, and much more depressed. So competing to avoid inferiority goes with this underlying sense that one is inferior, other people look down upon you, and that you have to be submissive in their presence. And so what we know is that body shame is linked to negative social comparison, self-criticism, very highly. Coming on now to BDD, this is thank David gave me this slide to use. These are some very specific kinds of problems that people with BDD experience, and they're all related in one way or another to fear focusing on body presentations. And at the root, I think, of a lot of the people that we work with, what is common, the triggers and the focus might be different. What's common to many of our people is the sense of being unloved, unwanted, shamed, and in some way cast out, being different, being disconnected. So what I would like to show you now is a video. Now, I couldn't get it to play directly, so I'm going to play it indirectly. Now, this is not actually a BDD, but it has smidgens of BDD, as you see, of a very depressed person. This is a program that we made for Channel 4 back in 1999, and then you'll also see a little bit about the therapy.
I'd stayed, and a car.
I'm 26, and I have a day job for a theatre and education company. And I'm also in a band, and that's really what I would like my future career to be in, to be a singer. I have a partner called Neil, and I've got a great family who I love very much. I don't know if there'll ever be a time where I can look in the mirror and say, that's it, that's what I wanted.
What do you think would make you happy?
I would rid my body of all excess fat. I would have a more dynamic hair colour. I would tan more easily. I'd grow my fingernails more successfully as I keep chewing them off. I'd have give myself thicker eyelashes.
How would you say your general state of mind is?
Well, just the feeling that you don't come up to scratch, really, and
there
that everyone else around you does.
Competitive.
And that you're powerless to be happy, really. And you, when you get down about it, it is literally like just this massive thing. It's like all-consuming, really.
What do you do at such times?
Just, it's not that you want to, but you just sort of wallow in it, really. Because that's all you can do. And it is like, it's like a downward spiral then. You may start feeling a bit dodgy, but you're okay, and then it'll just be something, and that's it. You go down the spiral. And it'll be those days that you see Claudia Schiffer, and that's it. You know, you may as well just get under the duvet.
She was a film star.
The rest of the day, really.
So just stay in bed.
It's almost like the kick you when you're down type idea, really. Women that are up there are deliberately made to be as attractive as is humanly and physically possible. So with that, you know, you can't help but look at them and think...
You think of a particular one?
God. Well, I mean, I think the last one we went to see was Sliding Doors and Gwyneth Paltrow. I mean, she really is naturally really attractive, isn't she? She seemed to lead this charmed life, basically, because she was so attractive, and that if you were that attractive, then, you know, that is a definite thing that I think, that, you know, the more attractive a person is, the happier they are, which is probably a gross sort of, you know, inaccuracy on my part, really, but that is certainly a way I think.
Do you worry about how people see you, you know, being seen? Is that...
Yeah. I've experienced a thing where, you know, if I've been in town, I've literally felt like I want to walk along like that, wanting to... just not let yourself be vulnerable, just have something there. And that's maybe where the staying in thing comes from. If you're just in your own house, you can just sort of... protect yourself. Just sort of sit in front of Jerry Springer instead. See people having emotional turmoil.
How does Helen strike you?
She's very self-critical. And she sometimes experiences that criticism as coming from outside and other people criticising her own critical thoughts coming in. She's, you know, I think what's happened is that she's internalised, you know, these media images and compares herself to them. So she's got this perfect person she's supposed to be physically, and is constantly finding that she's not like that.
The good news about Helen is that she's just...
She's just about to take some therapy. I moved it on because otherwise it's a bit too long. So we're going to just show you a little bit of therapy now, where we work with some of her self-criticism and what actually happens. It's quite a nice ending.
Can you think a little bit more?
So I ask her, what is it that makes you feel you're a fake and a failure as a woman? Because you feel she's no good as a woman.
About the kinds of thoughts, the kinds of situations that bring out in you this feeling of being a fake, failure, and just can't cope with it.
Even just something simple like being in town, maybe clothes shopping, and seeing other women, you know, and the continuous comparison thing, you know, she's tall, I'm not, she's slim, I'm not, she's tanned, I'm not, things like that.
Okay, so we'll call that your social comparison voice.
Okay.
What I'm going to ask you to do is to enact that voice. So what I'm going to do is get out of my chair. Ooh.
I'd hurt my back playing cricket, you know. Now, the other thing I should say is that they gave us a very tiny room to do this recording. Now, normally you wouldn't do it this way. You'd have separate chairs. But this was done, as I say, quite a long time ago. There we are. And it reminds me, I used to have before head of hair, which is always sad.
Okay, and I'm going to ask you if you would come and sit into this chair.
Okay.
So this is not ideal by any means.
Now that chair is now Helen who becomes depressed. And this chair is you.
So what we do then, is the first thing is to isolate the negative voice in the head so that you just become it, right? So. Whereas in cognitive therapy you might talk about it, we actually become it. So the idea is to become these different kinds of versions of you. So this is the critic, working with the internal critic. She called it the social comparison stuff, so we called it the same thing.
Telling Helen those things you just told me. You know, you're not as tall as her, you're not attractive as her. Okay, can you tell her?
Okay, that girl over there in the...
So this will be a stream of conscious thinking. This is her conscious thinking when she's going out shopping.
Corner of the changing rooms trying on those slinky trousers is at least 3 or 4 inches taller than you and slimmer than you. So you are, you know, kind of average in comparison.
So listen to the contempt. You see, you're average. Right, just average.
The two-chair technique is a technique which allows you to kind of isolate the negative voice in your head. So you can actually put it in a chair and let it speak to you and see what it says and explore its emotions and so forth.
So it said really becoming it and allowing it to be there and really getting into it and understanding what it wants to say.
You know, she just looks so much better than you, and everyone will think that. If you were to stand side by side, everyone would think she would look better than you.
And then you can go...
See that social comparison, the look of the other, the look of the other. Everybody will think that. So it's not just I think it, but everybody will think it. That look of the other.
Back into the other chair.
So now we've gone straight back into this chair. Notice this rapid change of whole physical state. We're not just changing cognitions. These are body states, right? So when we're in the critical chair, we're sitting up, we're... Thing. Now in the chair, we're with the criticized chair. This experience of being criticized, this actually is now closing down. You can see the body is closing down.
Experience what it's like to be talked at in this very critical way.
When you say things like that, it totally crushes me and reduces my worth to nothing. Physically, and I just want to curl up and die.
That exactly what was happening. She said it on the previous interview, where you just stay indoors, and she'd have this in her head, and sometimes she'd lay in bed and just think, there's no point, I'm never going to be attractive, I may as well kill myself.
Yeah.
So we're going to put her straight back in the other chair. Now, one of the most important things to note here is your critical self has no compassion. And one of the reasons is because it's not designed to, because it comes from your threat system. And your threat system turns empathy off in your brain, okay? The threat system turns empathy off. So if you're in the jungle and you hear the sound of a lion nearby, you don't need empathy. So I wonder if that lion has had a good day or a bad day. I wonder if there are emotions. You don't need it, right? So the more frightened we are, the less the empathic systems of the brain that we often need to help us, but they get turned off. That's not your fault. That's a wiring issue. So now this part of her has just heard this part of her say, when you say that to me, you so crush me, I want to kill myself. This part shows absolutely no compassion at all. It just does what it does and attacks.
Got this constant picture in your mind of how you really would like to look and how you would like to...
Look at the total different stance, sitting on her hands now, kicking her legs. Who's the strong one, huh? Right? Very different from over here. You've got this constant picture in your mind of how you want to look and all this stuff.
The clothes you'd like to wear and the everything, but you don't do it. Or you try, but you fail.
So she's just heard herself say, actually, when I have that voice in my head, I just feel so crushed, I want to kill myself. And this voice is saying, well, you try, but you fail. You fail. You know, the point is, if that dialogue continues day in, day out, and it does, you aren't going anywhere except down the tubes. Because you can't, because the systems that are being stimulated in your brain are all high threat, high depression systems. So let's put her back and see what happens. So she knows she's on the telly, she had a little laugh, but watch.
I know.
Look at that. Just despair, really. And that's because of her own self-attacking.
I just can't do it. I can't maintain it.
I'm going to come and sit in this chair. Now, what would you have...
We did a little bit more and she became quite emotional.
Gained
from... So what would you have gained from this?
From that?
Very little, I would imagine.
So what do you... Well, I'm not sure. What does that tell you?
That I'm far better qualified to drag myself down than I am anything else.
Absolutely.
Far more experienced in it.
Now that's a very, very important insight that we, when we work in compassion focused therapy, it's very important to realize that the source of what's dragging a lot of them down is their own attacking system. Okay? Their own attacking system which is there because it's to do with threat, because underneath the attacking system is the fear of disconnection, the fear of loneliness, the fear of not being loved, the fear of being worthless. Underneath the attacking system are these fears, but the attacking system will really hammer you. So you've got two problems. One is that you feel you're not very attractive, that's one thing, but then you've got this whacking every day, whack, 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 whack. Now your brain is just gonna, it can't do anything else. So there we go. So now that's interesting. Now the thing for us is that, you see, you could then say, okay, let's look at the evidence, blah, 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 blah. In compassion-focused therapy, we don't do any of that.
Absolutely right. That's exactly the point, that your critical skills are brilliant.
If I wanted a critic, I'd hire you. You are absolutely relentless. I mean, you're just amazing. You're vicious. You are. If I needed one, yeah, I'd have you, yeah.
Your helping skills, your compassionate side is not very well developed.
Mm. Your compassion side, though, is not very well developed. So that's the side of you that we're going to develop.
Therefore, that is the part of you that we need to develop.
And when we go to the workshop, I'll be talking a little bit about how we actually do that. So the last bit
between
now.
Between the first and second sessions, he asked me to kind of take note of situations where, you know, and write down a situation.
Was it quite strange, though, going to therapy? I mean, most people think therapy is sort of for loonies.
No, it's very laid back. It's just kind of like sitting chatting in a way, although it's obviously chatting about really stuff that, you know, what you've had for your tea or whatever. It's just been... It's liberating, actually, in a way, because you get to kind of put things into the place and piece things together, which is great. And when the pennies drop, it's just...
So she was a lovely girl. I mean, and a lot of the people we work with, Dave was saying, you're lovely, lovely people, really compassionate people. But it's like that compassion is locked behind steel doors when it comes to the self. They don't deserve it, it's a weakness, it's not going to help them. Sometimes when you begin compassion, they become overwhelmed with feelings of grief and sadness because like they become aware of how lonely and disconnected they have felt. Sometimes when you start compassion, they become aware of how much rage they count. So it's a tricky thing. So it's not that they're not compassionate. I mean, many of the people we work with are just lovely people, but their compassion for themselves is locked up because of the inability to, or the difficulties in processing anger and grieving. So when you begin to get hold of that and you're facilitated in the grieving and the anger process, then things can unfold.
A great feeling.
So have you actually seen any beautiful women that you've compared yourself to and then that you've applied what Paul's helped you to learn?
Actually, on the way down here today, on the bus, so I was sat on the bus and, you know, there was a girl walking up the road and just as the bus went past, I saw her. Now, she was probably about the same height as me, really slim, but she was really brown and had short blonde hair. So before, I think I would have thought, oh, she looks really attractive. Maybe I should have short blonde hair, maybe I should be brown, and kind of almost tried to be that person or mirror them and just take it all on. But today I thought, well, yes, she's attractive, but she's different. She's different to me. And just a general concept that attractiveness can be lots of different things.
So that's important because the compassion, that is the compassionate self speaking. That actually you are what you are. This is how you are. And your attractiveness is your attractiveness. But you can also appreciate the attractiveness of others. So you don't have to just see other people as a competitor. You can actually take appreciation in them. And Charlotte made exactly the same point of beginning to notice other women and the beauty of other women. And it doesn't reflect on you. It's not a negative. It doesn't have a negative impact on you. Whereas when we're socially comparing all the time, we think, you're better than me, and that makes me feel inferior. So that's quite an important thing. Now I've got to get out of here now. So when we're working, then it's interactional flow. So let's have a little bit look at the therapy. So the therapy then uses many, many of the interventions that other therapies use. Okay, so we're interested in the therapeutic relationship. So the relationship that we have with our folk, our wonderful people, is really important, that they have to feel to some degree safe with you and so on. Then we use Socratic questioning, guided discovery, and a whole lot of therapies that are well known in CBT, DBT, and so forth. But we do have some unique features as well. So one of the unique features is to help people recognize that the human brain is a complete and utter mess. It really is, okay? And this is because of a trade-off. There's lots of trade-offs in the brain. I'll give you one example of a trade-off that many of the ladies in the room will know. If you watch chimpanzees walk, they walk like this. Because when they want to run or move fast, they go onto all fours. Because your skeleton was designed in the sea and fish to be like that, right? And most primates are like that to some degree. Humans did this. They stood up. The problem with that is your legs come together and the birth canal becomes narrower right at the point that the baby's head is getting bigger. And so it turns out that human females have the most dangerous, the most painful births of all primates. It's a trade-off. In other words, it's disaster, right? It's disaster. And the other thing is that our babies are born much more immature than any other species. So those are downsides. Now, the human brain is full of these downsides, has many wonderful things, but actually it's also full of these glitches and clicks, which means that you very easily get into loops that you can't get out of and so forth. It's not your fault. The most important thing, whether you're depressed, paranoid, whatever it is, it's not your fault. Okay? You're dealing with a brain glitch. It's causing a lot of pain, a lot of suffering. You're trying to do the best you can to keep as safe as you can, to sort out your anxiety as best you can. Okay, so that's not your fault. The second thing is we have a model of emotional regulation which talks a lot about this capacity for positive emotion, which is soothing, which is has an impact on changing the way the brain works. Second, no it isn't, it's third, we focus on the idea of compassion motivation. In other words, we literally become like actors for a while, where we imagine being the most compassionate self we could be, and we walk around like that. We work on self-criticism. Obviously, that's a very major issue for us. By working with self-criticism in interactional dialogues in the way that you've seen, and we work with fears, blocks, and resistances. Okay. The thing about creating a secure base, I think what I'm going to do actually for the last few minutes, what I will do, which will probably be more interesting to you, is I'll show you a video which sort of brings this together a little bit. And that should actually then help us to see how the compassionate self works. Okay, so what we do then is we create and practice developing a compassionate self. We use various breathing techniques to get part of your autonomic nervous system working in a new way, in a different way. When you get this grounding, create this grounding, it affects your frontal cortex. When your frontal cortex starts to start working in threat situations, it gives you a way of dealing with threat. In our approach, we do not engage with threat processing until we have these capacities online. It's a little bit like climbing Mount Everest. If you want to climb Mount Everest, that's good. We can teach you rope skills and survival skills. But if you're not physically fit, you're probably not going to get very fast. So before we even go anywhere near your rope skills, we've got to get you physically fit. So here's a little video that was made for people with psychosis, but you'll get the hang of it. It's the same for... it's the same. Is it that one or is it that one? I'm not sure which one it is. Trying to get it to go large.
This is a film about Stuart. Stuart and his voices.
You can't do
football
it today.
No way.
Football.
This is psychosis voices.
Get up. Useless.
Critical voice.
These circles represent our three major emotion systems and how they are balanced. The threat system kicks in.
They're coming for you. They've set you up. They know what
you're... With people who have these kind of psychotic experiences that I work with, they often think that a lot of stimuli relate to them. So if they hear the police car coming, they think they're coming for you. If they heard there's a, you know, the police are looking for this particular person, they think, oh, they're looking for me. It's called ideas of reference.
They'll lock you up and never let you out.
Very frightening, very frightening.
You might as well give up now. This is too much. It's all too much. Pathetic.
See, now that's again idea of reference. He thinks, oh, the baby's crying, there's something about me. Then he looks around, do other people think there's something about me that's making the baby cry?
Stuart's drive system comes online.
Come on. Come on, Stuart. They don't want you in the team. Miss. Go on, miss.
Stuart is starting a therapy to help him cultivate compassion for himself, his feelings, and his voices.
Weak. You're weak for seeking therapy. You're weak. Be a man. Walk away. Don't trust her.
Over time, Stuart's therapist gradually helps him to feel more safe. They practice exercises that help him feel more grounded and still. Slowing down his body using breathing and imagery. Activating his soothing system. Stuart develops an image of an ideal, compassionate person, focusing on each of its compassionate qualities.
Sorry about that.
He tries to imagine what it would be like to step into this image and become this compassionate person. He walks around, acting the part of his compassionate self, getting a sense of what that would feel like, how he would think, what he would do. He practices at home as well, and gradually begins to deepen his understanding and sense of his compassionate self. As Stuart feels safer, stronger, and more courageous, he decides to start a conversation from his compassionate self to his most critical voice.
Hello, what do you want, loser? I want to understand you. I want to help you feel safe. Safe? Nothing's safe around here. If it wasn't for me, you'd be... I know you're trying to help me. Thank you. Thank you for reminding me that I get scared. You're right, I do. But I want to start overcoming my fears now. I'm ready. You want to get rid of me? No, I don't. I don't want to get rid of anyone. We can work on this together.
Hearing voices is a common human experience. It can often be linked to something difficult or painful that's happened in the past. Although tricky at times, with lots of practice and encouragement, Stuart's compassionate self becomes better developed.
Danger! Back to bed. You're not ready. It's okay, guys. Thanks for the warning. I'll keep an eye out, but there's things I need to do today. Hey, it's all right. We can manage this. We'll see. Hey!
Stuart now feels safe in relation to his voices. He understands and accepts them. They're very much part of the family, but no longer running the show. With his compassionate self in the driving seat, Stuart can now follow his true desires.
We will finish. So we have a sympathetic and a parasympathetic system. Your sympathetic system is what speeds things up. It's related to your threat system and so forth. Whereas your parasympathetic system has a tendency to calm things down. It slows your heart rate and changes things in your digestion and so on and so on. And it's particularly associated with ways of breathing and also with signals of affiliation and friendship. Okay? So the important thing is that feeling safe is not just the absence of threat. To feel safe, there is actually something positive that needs to happen. There is actually a system in your brain for detecting feeling safe. So when we feel safe, then it means we are connecting to an affiliative, soothing, understanding, validating part of ourselves that actually changes the wiring in our brain around threat. Whereas if we have a critical, hostile part that's constantly whacking into this, this is just growing and growing and growing, getting bigger and bigger. Okay? So I'm just going to move on to the last slide then, and there we are. But I'm not going to do that. Let me just come out of here and just show you the very last. Let me just show you this slide. Actually, this slide will be a nice one to finish on, actually. Okay. So, basically then, this is how it works. We use the new brain to be helpful. So if you see a meal, when you're very hungry, you see this wonderful meal, this will stimulate an area of your brain called your hypothalamus, which will make your stomach acids and saliva go. On the other hand, if you have no money or it's late at night and you just imagine this wonderful meal, if you're a meat eater, it might be steak. If you're a vegetarian, it might be a stuffed pepper. Oh, a stuffed pepper, I could die for a stuffed pepper. The image itself will do the same work, right? Now, if you see something erotic on EastEnders or something, I don't know. or your lover takes their clothes off and says, this will stimulate an area of your brain called your pituitary. And your pituitary will then release hormones into your body, and it's that release of hormones into your body that gives you arousal. And nature, not you, nature has designed these signals to do that. You don't want to get these two things confused, because then you get a Hannibal Lecter or something like that. And of course, the point is we know that we can also stimulate the pituitary, these very small set of cells in the pituitary, by what we imagine. We can create the imagination inside our own heads. And in fact, one of my patients said, oh, Dr. Gowie said, I much prefer imagination because you meet a better class of person. There's a lovely story, you probably know this one. What's the lightest thing in the world? The male penis, because it can be raised by thought alone. The point about it is that we recognize with these simple examples how powerful what we think and what we ruminate about is to what's happening in our brains, particularly our emotional brain. Okay? So if we get trapped in the focusing of self-criticism and feeling ugly and all other things that that torment you, if you get trapped there, then basically we're stimulating the brain in a certain kind of way. On the other hand, when people are kind to you and supportive to you, you're going to be stimulating a completely different set of brain pathways. And if I had the time, I'd show you the brains where these are being stimulated. And also, you're going to stimulate that parasympathetic system, which is exactly what you want to create a calming, wise state, which is what we did with Helen that you saw on the video. She practiced noticing this and moving to this, noticing this and moving to this. And so over time, gradually, making the decision that whenever this voice turns up, you're ugly, you are, look at that, you, blah, 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 then she would just take the breath, slow down, and just imagine if I was at my compassionate best, if I was helping somebody else with this, if I was really reaching out to be in contact and have the courage to be in contact with the pain that's being felt, and I have a genuine desire to heal, how would I be? What would my voice tone be? What would my thinking be? What would my behavior be? In other words, yes, I can be a critic. Yes, I can, as Helen said, put the boot in. I can kick me when I'm down. I can tell me how horrible and nasty I am. I can do all that. In fact, I'm brilliant at it. If I practice at it, I've got a fantastic critic. I can do it. It's no trouble with that. But do I want to do that? Am I that kind of person? What about if I become a compassion person that develops the courage and the wisdom to become a healer? And to become a healer in my own mind, and maybe then a healer for the minds of others. So when I focus on compassion, and I find the compassion in me, and many of the people we work with are wonderfully compassionate people, when we open the doors, we can begin to heal. Thank you very much.